Our next speaker is Nazar Kazak. He is a senior research scholar in the Department of Art Studies in the Ethnology Institute in the National Academy of Science of Ukraine. Previously, he taught art history at the Ivan Franko National University of Lviv. Kazak's primary research is on Byzantine and post-Byzantine art in Eastern Europe. More recently, he has begun to work on contemporary activist art. Currently, Kazak spends the fall semester as a scholar in the residence of the Getty Research Institute in Los Angeles, working on the research about artistic responses of Chernobyl disaster. And now his presentation, One Artist Army, Serhii Zakharov versus Russia's Military Visual Complex.
Thank you. 8/08/2008. That day, Russia invaded former Soviet Republic of Georgia. At that time, I was having my vacations in the remote Carpathian village with no internet connection, but with a satellite television instead. Among the channel selection, I found the channel named Russia Today. I watched it all 5 days of the war. It is from the Russia Today I learned that Georgia attacked Ossetia and the rockets falling from the night skies on the peaceful sleeping city of Tsinvali killed approximately 1,400 people. As a proof, they showed me this image of the Soviet brutalist architecture with smoke rising to the skies. Further, they told me that Russia has no other choice as launch a peace enforcement operation in order to stop no less no more than a genocide. Again, they showed me the image with the large inscription on the screen with this powerful word. In the end, although I understood quite well that Russia Today is a channel of pure propaganda disguised as in journalism, I nevertheless was convinced that in any conflict, both sides share the blame, and that Georgia was somehow responsible for the situation too. This served me as a moral justification when 4 years later I spoke at the conference in the State Institute of Art Studies in Moscow, and then next year in the same place I spoke again. And finally, I submitted a paper to a prestigious collection of studies sponsored by Russian state. All that was good for my academic visibility and my career. My article was published in February 2014, exactly the same time as Russian troops were deploying around Crimea, the territory of my own country, Ukraine. Most people do not see the war. What they see is an image of war. Thus, the war is not just an armed conflict, but also a conflict of images. People's attitude toward the war, their understanding of its causes, its objectives, and its flow are informed by the combination of images of war with the discursive framing of these images provided by channel through which people watch the war. The combination of images and their framing that I was exposed to in 2008, watching the Russo-Georgian conflict through the Russia Today channel, played its role in that I made a misleading conclusion about the war, and in result, accepted the neutralization of Russia's aggression, making a poor decision in terms of academic cooperation with the power, then constituted an immediate threat to my country and subsequently to me and my family as well. This relation and correlation between the watching the images of war and decisions that follow after that watching is what makes the study of visual dimension of war timely and important. In this paper, I address visual dimension of the ongoing Russo-Ukrainian war through the case study of Serhii Zakharov, who in July of 2014 organized an artistic resistance on the street of occupied Donetsk. More specifically, I am interested in how Zakharov's artworks operated as weapons in the context of image war on Donbas. The answer to this question, I believe, would contribute to a better understanding of art's agency toward the military conflicts in general. In what follows, I am going to provide that answer. First, however, let me briefly highlight the major stanzas of the Zakharov story, which gained much attention in the media both locally and internationally, and was also discussed even in some of the scholarly publications. So I suppose it should have been known to some of you. In summer 2014, refusing to accept the reality of Russia's occupation of his city, Zakharov decided to do something about it. He contacted his friends and invited them to join him in the Ukrainian resistance. After showing initial enthusiasm, his friends eventually evaporated, and he remained with only one another person who took an obligation to document Zakharov's activity. Officially, they named their group Murzilki. It's the plural of Murzilka. In Soviet slang, that word means a naive, foolish, small guy who is being played by big, bad guys. The artist ironically subverted the term, suggesting that naive and foolish small guy now will play those big and bad guys who got into power in Donetsk. Zakharov decided to produce a caricature images of occupants and place them on the street of the city. Since there was no time to paint directly on site, Zakharov decided to prefabricate the figures in his studio. He cut silhouettes from a cardboard, painted them, and brought them to the prepared locations. He worked only in early mornings, only once a week. Approaching the place, he stopped his car in some distance from the spot and then brought in artwork covered in a blanket by feet. After installing the figure, he left, and as a member of the team, photographed all the process. And same day, in the evening, images were posted on the internet. Zakharov's works attracted substantial attention from media. After he was contacted by a Russian journalist from the TV channel Dozhd, he was tracked and captured. During his 2 months captivity, Zakharov was tortured and even subjugated to stage mock executions. After his release, he left Donetsk and moved to Kyiv, where he replicated his artworks from Donetsk for several exhibitions and eventually produced a graphic novel which tells the whole story in the series of striking drawings. Zakharov's story attracted journalists and they called him Banksy of Donetsk, or Ukraine's Banksy, referring to an anonymous English street artist who is famous for his images that combine dark humor and irony with witty commentaries on social political issues. This vision of Zakharov as a street artist who indulged in provocative practices in urban environment infiltrated into scholarly publications too, where it received more academic polish. For instance, H.H. Fesenko reads Zakharov's activity as a response to the conflict which demonstrates, I quote, civic responsibility for informational content of the common space of the street, while N.M. Homa sees Zakharov's work as manifestation of the artist's opposition, his protest against reality. And Yulia Ischuk contextualized Zakharov in line with cultural production of such figures in Ukrainian literature as Serhii Zhadan and Olena Stepova, who challenged the former Soviet myth of the Donbas as proletarian region and created its new text, which focuses on identities of individuals, contrary to those imposed by official ideologies, either Ukrainian national or separatist. Ischuk reads Zakharov's works as an attempt to infiltrate people's mind and claims that he challenges the separatist identity of his native Donetsk. Of course, Zakharov's works share all these aspects, the guerrilla street art tactics, the civic responsibility, the protest, and the challenging of the myth. But what, however, remains overlooked in these readings is that Zakharov artworks interfere with Russia's military visual complex. I borrow the notion of military visual context from Nicholas Mirzoyev, who modeled it on military industrial complex, thus referring to all the multiplicity of visual production sponsored by the state power in order to control the visual dimension of war. My point is that Zakharov's work could be understood only in conjunction vis-a-vis on the enemy's side, These are two sides of the same coin, and they should be analyzed together. Zakharov's artworks appeared on the street of Donetsk in July. That was the month of active military engagement when the Ukrainian army was successful in the liberation of occupied territories. Here you see two maps showing the situation in the beginning and in the end of the month. In that time, Russian propaganda constantly denied Russia's involvement in the conflict, and its media resources attempted to represent the war as a separatist rebellion of the province which resisted the fascist politics of the central authorities. Mostly, this was achieved through videos which featured interviews with an assumed locals who spoke anti-Ukrainian rhetoric, blaming central authorities in war crimes and atrocities, such as, for instance, crucified child in Slovyansk. Zakharov's works directed against Russia occupation that appeared in the street of Donetsk contradicted the narrative of rebellious province. Taking the position of a rebel himself, Zakharov turned over the table and put the invaders into position of oppressive authorities. Staging the rebellion against rebellion, Zakharov challenged not an identity, but a narrative fabricated by Russia's propaganda. Another important aspect of Russian military visual complex, which Zakharov's works undermined, was the construct of the hero of New Russia. On May 22, 2014, so-called People's Republic of Donetsk and Lugansk declared the formation of a union state, which they named as New Russia, Novorossiya in Russian, referring to a historic province of the Russian Empire, which corresponds to the southeastern region of present-day Ukraine. The new country needed its media heroes. Zakharov specifically targeted those figures, representing them in ironical life. Probably the most famous of Zakharov images is this one. It represents a portrait of the Russian rebel leader, Russian citizen, and an officer of Afshin army, Igor Girkin, known by his pseudonym as Strelkov. You saw him on the previous image, who played the major role in the initial phase of invasion in Donbass. Zakharov depicted him shooting himself in the head. This is a reference to common saying, go shoot yourself, which is used as a reaction to the action which with terrible consequences. Zakharov painted that image after Russian rebels shot down the Malaysia airline Flight 17 over Ukraine, and this way killed 15 crew members and 283 passengers, including 80 children. The naive style of the painting, in combination with the advertisement motto of Nike Corporation, just do it, dismantled the monumentalized heroic figure of Strelkov that was constructed by Russian media and substituted with a pejorative counter-image that makes us smile. In this installation, Zakharov located near the local civil marriage register office. It features the image of Russian citizen Arseny Pavlov, a leader of the Sparta battalion known under the pseudonym Motorola. He came to Donbass because he believed that it is a Russian land and he wanted to protect Russian population from Ukrainian fascists. Leaving his family behind, he remarried to 20 years old Alena Kolenkina from Slovyansk. Zakharov exaggerated the difference in stature between the bride and the groom, transforming them into Russian version of the Gomez and Morticia from the Adams family. Zakharov also works with the details. Motorola's image has a devil's tail and legs, while his wife Alena wears a hostel with the gun over her bride's dress. Making fun of New Russia's heroes in reception of Russian rebels, Zakharov acted as an iconoclast. Artist mentions that his captors told him that depicting Strelkov that way, he had spit on their icon. In his graphic novel, Zakharov rendered that episode with an image of Strelkov reminiscent of a saint. This claim about spitting on the icon points out that images are not just a combination of color and lines on the surface, but are more complex entities which, as Hans Belting once wrote, are neither on the wall nor in the head alone, which do not exist by themselves, and which instead happen via transmission and perception. Zakharov's images of the new Russia's heroes clearly interfere with their vis-a-vis produced by Russia's military visual complex. The latter demanded adoration, while the former make us laugh. There is nothing noble and heroic neither in Strelkov shooting himself, neither in Motorola with his wife. These images are comic. In Russian perception, Zakharov acted similarly to the cartoonist of the Parisian Charlie Hebdo magazine, who constantly published jokes about Islam and Muhammad, and which radical Islamists perceive as blasphemous. This image motivated the fanatics to execute the magazine staff in 2015. And notably, that during his captivity, Zakharov was also subjugated to mock execution by Russians. Despite the Russian reading of Zakharov's works as iconoclastic may seem reasonable, it, however, does not fit well into classic definition of iconoclasm. Zakharov was not an enemy of images per se. Rather, he was an enemy of the images produced by the enemies. Yet again, he did not smash them, did not destroy them. His strategy fits better into what W.T.J. Mitchell described as critical idolatry, the approach that does not seek to destroy the idol, but to hit it with critical thinking so that to make it reveal its weakness. I quote, "The power of idol over the human mind resides in their silence, their spectacular impassiveness, their dumb insistence on repeating the same message, and their capacity for absorbing human desire and violence and projecting it back to us as a demand for human sacrifice." Zakharov hit the new Russian idols with ironic visuality, making them speak in a ridiculous way their constructors would never wanted them to. We need also to consider Zakharov's strategy of dissemination of his works, since it is an important part of the project. The figures he produced did not survive for long. They were taken down same day, but the photographs of those works are still in circulation. In this system, it is not that an original image has an importance, but it is the image of that image, or to say in one word, a meta-image that comes to the fore stage. Posted on social media, photographs representing Zakharov's works went viral and eventually were reposted by international news agency and featured in such headliners as Guardian, for instance. We see them today here at that screen, and thus they still alive and still work as weapons in the war of images. All in all, the condensed version of my answer to the initial question about how did Zakharov images has functions and weapons in the war of images within Russo-Ukrainian conflict would right now read as follows. Deployed on the streets of the occupied Donetsk, in time when Ukrainian army was regaining control over Donbass, Zakharov artworks signaled the presence of pro-Ukrainian resistance behind the front line and thus dismantled the narrative of the rebellious province as a cover-up for Russia's invasion of Ukraine. Moreover, by using irony in his works, Zakharov subverted the heroic idols of New Russia, Novorossiya, reducing them to caricatures of themselves, powerless in their comicality. In terms of dissemination, a meta-image, an image of an image, is what gained a central place in Zakharov project, proliferating through grassroots informational channels of private accounts and social media into the major news agencies with the audience of millions. In the end, I would like to address two possible objections against validity of my conclusion and my approach in general. First, I am aware of a philosophical position that demands the weaponizing of art and insists that this form of human activity should be kept away from any political purpose and remain within the realm of pure sensuality and aesthetic pleasure. I understand this, but I reject this as irrelevant, as unrelevant to my life. Albert Camus, in his 1958 essay entitled Create Dangerously, described the new situation with arts after World War II and refers to the metaphor of Roman amphitheater with lions and martyrs. Camus argued that through all of the history, artists remain on the sideline of the arena. I quote, "They sang for no reason, for their own pleasure, or in the best of cases, to encourage the martyr and attempt to distract the lion from its prey." While after World War II, artists were brutally thrown into arena itself. When artists speak out, their claims are being attacked. And when they remain silent, their silence is being attacked too. The silence became as much an expression of political position as passionate claim. In present regime of visual democracy, when everyone is capable to produce and to frame the images, Camus' diagnosis seems to be valid even more. This regime of mass production and reproduction of images eliminates the possibility of being at the sideline per se. What is left for the artist is only arena, and what is left for our historians is to embrace that reality and to stop denying it. Second, I am aware that art is not that powerful as one would like it to be. Indeed, when we look on what Hevar Zakharov achieved in political terms, we need to admit that he achieved nothing. Donetsk is still occupied. Russia's military visual complex still operates. While Zakharov himself became a displaced person who faces financial difficulties and who, despite his fame, did not receive any acknowledgement from the governmental institution, any sense of insured future. His graphic novel, which costs just $8 per copy, does not sell well. Moreover, in new Ukrainian realities, his work is even censored. This year, during presidential elections, he installed replicas of his 2014 caricatures in one of Kyiv's museums. But they were removed from the exhibition because the curator found that this image of a green clown, the artist repeated it in green intentionally, reverberates too much explicitly with Volodymyr Zelensky campaign, which used the green color as its major marker and who is a professional comedian. Although Zakharov never stops, and recently he installed a green matryoshka during the protest rally in front of the presidential office. Probably you see that he corrected the letter C in the word since into Z, and thus he received the Z, actually what is again the reference to presidential campaign. But again, that had no traceable consequences. Zelensky idol is still in his office. With its silence and with its same message repeated over and over again, and with its capacity to absorb human desires, I am rephrasing here Mitchell again, he continues to deceive the Ukrainian masses. Of course, this is frustrating and makes me doubt the necessity of all artistic efforts such as Zakharov's, as well as doubt the necessity to discuss them in academic framework. Recently, however, I had a chance to ask Jay Jurel about how to deal with that confusion. Jurel is an American artist who played a major role in establishing black arts movement in the 1960s. She is known for her fashion suits, which she designed with elements of militancy in order to empower her community for the revolution. Thinking about Ukrainian backlash, I ask her how to deal with the frustration that emerges when your community turns away from what you are fighting for in its name. First, she said that she did not quite understand the question. But eventually, she gave a personal speech, main point of which was that if you are an artist, then your participation in revolution is not about the fighting in literal sense of the word. What you do instead is you are focusing on expressing. You as an artist have to be happy until you have the possibility to express, and you have to hope that your expression will help others in their struggle for the common goal. Just say what you need to say and move on, Gerald told me. And that is what I'm going to do. I'm going to move on. Thank you.